Hey everyone, welcome to the first video of my playthrough of Super Mario Advance 4, Super Mario Bros. 3. My last Super Mario playthrough was New Super Mario Bros. Wii, I went through that again. And during that, I noted that the next one would be Super Mario Bros. 3, and I had every intention of uploading the NES version of the game, you know, like I originally did a few years ago on my channel. I think sometime after I said that, this version came out, and then I found out that this version, and by this version I mean the Wii U Virtual Console version, actually included all the e-reader levels, some of which were never released anywhere. It includes all of them, so I was like, you know what, I think I'm gonna cover this version instead. Not that I won't cover the NES version, you know, sometime down the line, but I wanted to cover this version first because I'd say it's probably the definitive version of Super Mario Bros. 3, just because it has so much content. Just a little backstory before I start. Super Mario Bros. 3 was originally released on the NES back in 1990 in the US. It was remade in 1993 as part of the Super Mario All-Stars compilation. Now, the GBA version is a port of the Super Nintendo version of Super Mario Bros. 3. It's starting to get confusing, but it'll be clear in a moment. This version includes some new enhancements, like there's an intro, as you'll see in a moment. There is voice samples, new sprites, and as I mentioned earlier, a new set of levels in the form of World E. Now, the e-reader was a peripheral for the Game Boy Advance. It was really complicated, and it was actually not really well implemented. The idea was cool. You know, Nintendo kind of uses that idea now with scanning in new content for games with Amiibo. This is kind of like a predecessor to that, but you needed a separate accessory to actually scan these cards in, called the e-reader. And what you needed was two Game Boy Advances, this game and the e-reader, and then some cards. So it was a very complicated process. But later on in 2016, Super Mario Advance 4 was released on the Wii U, and it includes World E, which is the bonus world that you could unlock with cards. This version includes all the levels, like I mentioned earlier. Some of them were never released, and in Europe, the e-reader was never released over there, so everybody in Europe never even got to play these levels, and they never even had a chance to play these levels. But yeah, I will be covering all the worlds in the game. I'm not going to skip any of them. And then after I beat the regular game, I'm going to go through World E. Okay, I just want to get all that out of the way. For now, let's get started. Thank you. Okay, I'm going to cover the single player mode. So, Super Mario Advance 4 includes two modes, two main modes. Super Mario Bros. 3, which is, as I mentioned, a port of the SNES version of it. And then Mario Brothers, which is a remake of the original Mario Brothers, you know, the one that was on the NES and was in arcades too. It's like a remake of that. I'm not really going to cover that here, so let's just go with Super Mario Bros. 3. Okay, I always thought that intro was weird because, like, basically Mario and Luigi are attacking each other, but anyway, let's get started here. Okay, World 1. This is Grassland? You know, I can't remember because some of the names changed between versions. I'll call it Grassland for now, but I'm sure it has, you know, a more up-to-date name. World 1. There you go. Okay. So I'm playing the Wii U Virtual Console version, as I noted before, and it's really weird because I'm playing on the gamepad. I'm not used to playing on this anymore. I've been playing my Switch, and for those of you that have the Switch, and then, you know, if you go back and play a Wii U game on the gamepad, it's a lot different. The gamepad is very big and clunky, whereas the Switch is very thin, and it feels a little better on in your hands. I mean, not that the Wii U, you know, isn't that comfortable. I mean, I'm getting kind of used to it again, but it's a big difference between this and the Switch. Okay, we're gonna fly up here, and this is something new as well. These bonus areas actually have different music. It's like a unique tune to the Game Boy Advance version. Okay, there's like some secrets and stuff like that, like the coin ship. I'm not going to cover that now just because, well, I've unlocked it before. I think those of you that watched my original playthrough of this game on the NES, you probably saw that I accidentally unlocked the coin ship in World 3, I think it was. There are very specific things you need to do in order to see the coin ship, or whatever it's called, and I accidentally did it in the original playthrough. I don't know how to do it off the top of my head. I could look it up, but I'm just gonna go to World 1-2. These first few levels, I apologize in advance if I'm just running through them, because these are really easy, and I've played through these levels so many times. And I just got hit. That's just great. Well, I'm gonna get another leaf in a moment, so it's not a big deal. Okay, so you can freeze these coins. They turn into blocks. You can go in here, and there's more coins. And those coins up there, I think those were added in this version, because I do not remember seeing those in any other version. Okay, we're gonna go back up here. Whoa. Let me get rid of these guys first. But yeah, the World E levels, I haven't played those yet. There's a one up here. There we go. I haven't played those yet. I kind of do want to play them, you know, before I get to them here. But it's interesting because you can actually play them off the bat in this game, or in this version, I should say, the Wii U version. There's like a menu that was added where you can just play them outright. So it's, oh, I messed up. You can run at that at full speed and you'll always get a star. But I was talking. I wasn't paying attention. Anyway, yes, you can play World E right off the bat. It's basically like its own game, almost, and it's included here. That's why I think this is the definitive version of Super Mario Bros. 3, because World E has so many levels. It's like hours and hours of content. I don't think it's as long as this campaign, but like I said, you get hours worth of levels. I've seen some footage of the levels a while ago. Just like a couple, but you know, like I said, some of those levels weren't available at all because the, you know, e-reader was dropped very, very quickly, and you know, not all the cards were released in the US. Oh, Actually, I don't know if all of them were released in Japan either. I'm not too knowledgeable on the e-reader because, you know, I kind of wanted it when I was younger, but at the same time, it was just like, eh. But yeah, I'll cover the World E levels after I beat this game. Okay, after the third row of coins, you want to fly up, there's a 1-up that you can get. Let's get it. Cool. So yeah, there's voice samples in the game now. I think they're... Most of them are probably pulled from other Mario games. I have the volume turned down, I can't really hear. Okay, and let's get our first secret, and I keep forgetting you can't hold on to those. I think Super Mario World was the first game you could hold on to. I mean, not hold on to them, but like throw them upward. Okay, but yeah, you want to crouch down on the white blocks. Any white blocks, you can do that. I think the first level had those, but this one actually leads somewhere. And Toad's new sprite, he has a new sprite here in this version, and it's ugly. I don't like it. Because I think on the Super Nintendo version and the NES version, he had no mouth. But here, he's just grinning like an idiot, and it doesn't look good. Okay, yeah, I got a warp whistle back there. Sorry, like I said, I'm just kind of going through these levels really quick, because these are really easy ones, and they're short levels too. But the warp whistle will allow you to... Actually, is it the L button? Yeah. To skip some worlds. I'm not going to bother. I'm just going to go through all of them. Oh, if you notice on the map screen, you actually get more slots for items as well. Overall, this version is easier than the original NES version. There's some... Actually, I'll point it out later. But there's some parts in this game, or in this version, I should say, that are way easier than on the NES. I mean, like I said, I might go through the NES version again someday. I just... You know, wanted to go through this version because there's more stuff to go through. Gosh, you can really rack up the lives here. You know, another flaw with the NES version is I can't save. I mean, I have it on Virtual Console, so I could save, but if I was playing on the actual NES, I wouldn't be able to save. So I'd have to do it all in one go, which I don't have time for. Okay, so yeah, this was the game's first auto-scrolling level. It's pretty easy. The boomerang bro here. Oh! We hit each other. Okay, well, I didn't get the 1-up bonus. If you get 3 of the same icon, specifically the star, you get the most lives, but if you get 3 of the same icon, you get more lives, but as you can see here, I have 12 lives. I'm not really, in need of lives. His new sprite's so ugly. I think they should have moved the mouth down a little bit. Okay, I'm not good at this minigame. You just have to match up the 3... Oh. Okay, I thought I messed up. I think I messed up. Yep. I hit it a little too early, so it was gonna go on the star. It looked like the mushroom had saber-toothed tiger teeth. Okay, anyway, this is the first fortress of the game. This video is going to include all of World 1. The later videos will split up the worlds into at least 2 videos, so... Whoa, I almost got hit there. Oh! I don't have the leaf! I can't get the warp whistle. Wait, I can't remember if there's a leaf at the end here. Please... Okay, good. Oof. I don't know if that's there in the NES version, but... Here it's good, because I can actually fly up here. So this is the area that was shown in the movie The Wizard, which was released before the US release of Super Mario Bros. 3, so that was how people found out how to get that, and that movie is just silly. If you've never seen that before, it's a product of its time, basically. I've seen it before. I've seen it a couple times. It's silly. Alright, World 1-5. See, one thing I kind of miss about the NES version, the caves were kind of like ice caves. I don't know if they were supposed to be like that, but, you know, the ground, instead of being brown, is white. I thought it looked cool. I'm gonna let you know in advance, I'm skipping most of this level because there's more stuff, like, on this top side. The bottom side just has a bunch of enemies. Nothing worth showing. I mean, if it was worth showing, I would show it, but you're not missing anything. Wait, was that? This is the third row, I think. Oh, yeah. Oh, I almost missed that. Yeah, sometimes I'm concentrating more on, you know, what I want to talk about instead of the actual gameplay. I don't need that. Well, no, I'm not going to show it. There's really nothing down there. That was, like, the best part of it, just that fire flower if you need it. Or if you're small Mario, if you need a mushroom. I read about this recently, and I kind of knew it, but, you know, just reading it recently kind of reminded me of it. In the Japanese Super Mario Bros. 3 on the NES, it was much more difficult because when Mario had a power-up and he got hit, he would turn into small Mario. But in the Western versions, and I think all other remakes and re-releases, when Mario got hit with a power-up, he would just turn into Super Mario. If you remember, it was like that in the original Super Mario Brothers, but yeah, that was changed. But anyway, 1-6. Okay, for a moment I thought this was auto-scrolling, it's not. There's just one auto-scrolling level in this world, and I already went through it. Ooh, I almost got hit there. Yeah, sometimes, I never really found out why. There is a reason why. I think there's a reason why. But sometimes the 1-up mushroom, or any power-up, if you hit it, it'll go like the opposite way. I never figured out why. But I think there is a reason why. This is something different here too. Very noticeable. In the NES version, there's one block here. In this version, there's two. I mean, honestly, it's really not... There, I don't think there was that much of a point to add that second block, but I think this part's longer too. Okay, yeah, I didn't run at this at full speed, so no star for me. Oh, okay, this is a bonus game that shows up after a little bit. There's some things that you have to do, I think, in order for this to show up. I used to memorize, like, all the tables. Let's see what this is. Oh, no, I don't know this one. I think these two... Oh, no! Okay, yeah. Yeah, it's crazy to think that, you know, when I was younger, I could memorize all those tables. Now I just remember, like, very little of it. It would have been nice to have some items, but I did get a, actually, you know, I don't need the raccoon tail right now. I'll just take this. But yeah, I don't really need items now. Later on in the game, yes, I will need items. This world is easy enough. And plus, I have a mushroom house here. I already went to one. Cool. Wow, you really get a lot of item slots in this version. Okay, so the first boss here is Larry. He was in the intro, and his sprite looks really different. Like, he had white hair. Some of the Koopalings... Actually, I think... Well, no, not all of them, but most of them do look different in this version. Well, not just this version. In Super Mario Bros. 3 in general, they look different, because this was their first appearance. So, their colors and some of their appearances, especially Iggy... will look vastly different than how some of you might know them now. For those of you that are wondering, this version on the Wii U actually looks really good. You know, some of the GBA games on Wii U don't look as good because they're kind of stretched out, but this looks really good. It sounds, you know, a little better than on the GBA. But honestly, I'm not a huge fan of how the songs sound on the Game Boy Advance version. But then again, I kind of prefer the NES soundtrack to the SNES one. Oh my gosh, I got freaking hit by Larry. Okay, but yeah, I was hitting the wrong button. That's why I like started throwing fireballs. I don't really care about throwing fireballs at the Koopalings. Well, it's easy enough. He doesn't really have any special attacks like his siblings. Yeah, one of the things I used to do while waiting for you know, this scene here, I used to try to count the clouds. I think there was 20 there. Okay, so the ruler of World 1, he's back to his normal self, and he gave us a letter from... Oh, it still says Princess Toadstool. For some reason, I thought it was edited to say Peach, but it still says Toadstool in this version, too. Okay, and she gave us a P-Wing. That is a really good item. Basically, it's the raccoon tail, but you can fly as long as you want, as long as you're hitting the jump button. Now, that's a new thing, too. If you beat all the levels in a world, you get this little scene. It says perfect clear. Okay, and we've made it to World 2. This is obviously a desert-themed world, and we're going to get to this in the next video. So yeah, like I said, we're going to go through all the levels in the game, and then after that, I might upload some bonus content, I'm not sure yet, but I'll definitely cover World E after all the game's done. But yeah, anyway, I'm really excited to go through this game. I love Super Mario Bros. 3. It's one of my favorite games of all time. It was actually one of the first video games I played too, so I got a, you know, good start on playing video games. But yeah, thanks for watching, and I will see you next time. Thank you.